Alright, so welcome to the final part of the vehicle dynamics series. I am Nikhil, and in today's video we will see what are the special cases that you need to deal curves, various types of curves around the Spanish Grand Prix circuit. And at the end of the video I will have a surprise for you, so keep watching. Let's begin this. So in this part 5 we will see how to find the lap time of the Barcelona circuit, and this will be the concluding video. And let's begin this. So in this video we will see what is a straight curve, what is a curve within a straight, and then curve with increasing radius, and then curve with decreasing radius, and curve with radius increase and then decrease, and what is meant by critical radius. So we will see each of these special cases one by one. So here there is a straight piece of track, and then you have a curve that is shown and in the figure like this. So first you have to accelerate along the straight, and then you need to brake at the right point and make sure that you maintain the proper speed into the corner, right? So this is the first case. So in the second case, you are trying to exit the corner and you are going down the straight like this, okay? So first you will maintain the limit speed, and then once you exit the corner, you start accelerating. So that is case 2. In case 3, you have a small piece of curve that is sharp, and then you have a curve that is having a large radius, okay? So that means you will first maintain the limit speed, and then you start accelerating to the next maximum limit speed, okay? So you cannot continuously accelerate in this particular case, but you can accelerate up to the maximum limit that the upcoming curve can allow you, okay? So in the fourth case it is quite opposite. So you are coming with a section with larger radius, and then you have a sharper section. So then you have to brake into that particular section so that you can maintain the limit speed, which is less than the current speed. And in the final case, there is a combination of increasing radius and decreasing radius. First you enter with a sharp corner, and then the curve gets lean with increasing radius, and then again the curve gets sharp. So first you start with some minimum velocity, and then you accelerate into the next corner, and then you maintain that speed, and then brake into that particular corner itself to be able to maintain the limit speed of the sharpest corner that is coming ahead. Okay, so these are the five cases. Okay, so there is another special case that is known as concept of critical radius. So in the expression for limiting velocity, in the denominator you have m by r minus mu into cl by 2 into rho times af. Okay, so if m by r will become equal to the right hand side expression, that is r times mu times cl times rho times af, then the denominator will become 0 and the limiting speed will become infinite. So that means it can be considered as a straight piece of track. That means the velocity limit is infinite, so you can go up to any speed on that particular curve. Okay, so in such a scenario what we do is we consider that the curve is straight in nature. Okay, so this is the form of a critical radius. After substituting the values, you get r is equal to m divided by half into mu into cl into rho into af. Okay, so that will give a value of 203.13 meters. So that is depending on the particular r value. Okay, that depends on the mu value, rho value, af value, and cl value, and those values are specific to the car. Okay, so for this particular example of the car that we took, we are getting a critical radius of 203 meters. So if the radius of the curve is greater than 203 meters, the car has more than sufficient grip even at infinite speed, and hence it can be considered as a straight ride. Okay, so now we have seen all the different cases of what type of curves can be expected when you are driving along the circuit, and now we will go and look at what the circuit is model like. So we took the Barcelona circuit, which is there in Spain. Okay, that is shown in this map here. So we will try to zoom in. Okay, so you are getting a zoomed view of the Spanish Grand Prix circuit. Okay, that is also known as Circuit de Barcelona. Okay, so what it is, I took a screenshot of this, and then I imported that image into Autodesk Fusion 360. Okay, so this is the Autodesk Fusion 360 CAD software. So what I did is I took a canvas. Okay, so this particular thing is the canvas. Onto this canvas I have imported this Google image, and on top of this I drew the lines and arcs to make the tracing line. Okay, on top of this I drew the sketch. So let me just show you the sketch. Okay, so this is the sketch. See, it is consisting of lines and then arc like this. Okay. So, if you are not able to see the circuit behind, let me just increase the opacity. So, I think now you are seeing it, right? So, I have placed this racing line using lines and arcs, okay? And I have given the dimensions for all of them, okay? So, in order to obtain the exact scale of the circuit, what I did is, I first made an Excel sheet having length of the straight and radius of the curve, okay? And you also have angle. So, in order to get the length of the curve, you will do this particular calculation, that is pi by 180 into angle in degrees into radius of the arc will give you the length of the arc, right? Because angle is equal to arc by length. So, this is the length of the straight. So, in that case, I am just giving as radius 0. Okay. Actually, this is infinite radius, but I am just marking it with 0. And I obtained the length for all the track sections like this. Okay. After obtaining all the lengths, I summed up using this particular formula here. Okay. I summed up all of them and it is giving me a value of 708. Okay. But we know that the real circuit length is 4.655 kilometers. Okay, that is 4,655 meters. So the multiplication ratio will be 4,655 divided by 708. Okay, so that will give me a multiplication ratio of 6.57448. Okay, so after obtaining this multiplication ratio, I multiplied each and every circuit section with this particular value so that I will get the true length. Okay, so these are the real lengths of the circuit. So that's how we obtain the practical data. Okay, so now the scenario is, I will start with a particular corner, okay? So, the trick here is, you need to start with the sharpest possible corner so that you will get the correct values in the first iteration itself, okay? So, in the quasi-steady state modeling, what we do is, we generally start with some random point and then we iterate around the main circuit, okay? You will be iterating. Like you will start with this particular point right here and then you will go down calculating all this length, okay, and you will come back to the point and then you will repeat the same till you reach convergence. So as it is a time consuming process, the other workaround way is you start with the sharpest corner. In this particular circuit, the sharpest corner is the corner 10, okay. So I am starting with corner 10 and I will start simulating and calculating all the lengths till I reach that point, okay. So I started with corner 10 here and I obtained all these section times from MATLAB functions, okay. So now as an example, I will just show you this particular first example and then which is consisting of a straight and a curve, and in second example we will see curves with a different radius, okay. So this is the function we took to get the breaking point in the previous video, that is video part 4, okay. So now we are introducing the time term also here, okay. So for time, we are using this formula. Time is equal to distance by instantaneous speed during acceleration, okay. So distance will be 1 meter, that is the instantaneous incremental step, okay. So the step size is 1 meter and you are using instantaneous speed, that is V of I, okay. And while braking, we are using a different formula because there the speed actually changes the pace, okay. So we are using speed difference of braking divided by deceleration rate. So deceleration rate, we use a constant value of 2.5 g, okay. So when you add both acceleration and deceleration times, you get the total section time, okay. So that is tr plus tb. So that is what I implemented. So firstly, I am taking the values of le, that is the length of the track section, rc is the radius of the upcoming corner, and vi is the initial velocity, okay. So after taking these values, I am starting with the for loop. We have already seen this in the previous video, but here we are introducing the time term also. So here time is equal to time plus 1 by V of I. 1 is 1 meter and V of I is the instantaneous velocity. Okay. And time will initially start with the time is equal to 0 seconds. And when you run this for loop, it will keep on adding the time for every 1 meter. Okay. So you are starting with 1 meter, then 2 meters, then 3 meters, so on. You are adding the times for each section and finally you are getting the total time. Okay, that is for acceleration. Similarly, for deceleration, we are finding time is equal to time plus V3 minus V2 by 24.52. V3 minus V2 is nothing but the speed difference between the point of braking to the point of entering the curve. Okay. So this 24.52 is nothing but the 2.5 g.
So now you are just checking.
So actually this is an iterative process.
So in order to get the
perfect braking point, you are checking whether it is within 1% limit or not. And if this is in within 1% limit error, then you are sending these values to the output variable. Okay. So now I'll just try this to run this function. So now we'll try to run this function. The length of the track section is 1084 meters and the radius of the upcoming corner is 77.8 meters and the car is entering the straight with the speed of 64.95 meter per second. Okay. That value is given here. Okay. That is the radius of the upcoming corner. The car is entering with initial speed of 64. That is when you first get this particular value here from this value. 64,
that is written here.
The 64 is going to the main straight. Okay. So this is the turn 16. So from this turn 16, the car is entering the main straight. Okay. So initially started with this particular point, that is turn 10. But as an example, I am showing the main straight. So after running this function, we will get first the section time. The section time is 13.0441 seconds. Okay. So that means the car takes 13.04 seconds to travel the main pit straight. Okay. And this is the distance at which the car is braking. Okay. So after accelerating for 945 meters, the car is applying brakes. Okay. And the maximum speed obtained in this phase is 93 meter per second. So that is also given in this particular vector sheet. That's how we obtain these values. Okay. So similarly, we will see if the radius of the curve is changing, we are using another function. So in this function, you are taking the length of the curve, you are taking the radius of the current corner, that is RCI, and you are taking the radius of the next corner, that is RC. Okay. So first you are finding what is the limit velocity when the circuit radius is RCI. Okay. So this particular line will give you the wheeling. And for V2, you are using RC. RC is the radius of the next curve. So I am again running a for loop from x is equal to 1 to LE. Okay. And I am just maintaining the speed at VI. Okay. So here I have given V of 1 is equal to VL. So I am starting with the limiting velocity and I am calculating the time. Okay. So in the first piece of the track, there will be no change in the velocity and the car is maintaining at the same speed. So, but in the next section, the car is decelerating from V2 to V3. Okay.
V3 is nothing but the end of the section
and V4 is the braking velocity to the next corner. So, braking I have applied 2.5 g here, that is 24.52, and I am using LE minus X. So, the car has maintained the speed for X meters and it is braking for the next meters, that is nothing but LE minus X. Okay, so I am again using this timeline. So I am adding both braking times as well as constant speed times. So I am then displaying the results. So
this break statement actually breaks out of the loop
when this particular function is reached. That is, the both velocities should meet at a point where the error is less than 1%. So I will use this curve decreasing function. Okay.
So,
as an example, I will use this. Turn number 11. Okay.
So, in turn number 11,
initially the radius of the circuit is 82 meters and it is changing to 61 meters. Okay. So, when the radius of the curve is changing like this, you should use this particular function, curve decreasing.
So, I have used the initial radius and then I have used the decreased radius into this particular function, and 69 is the length of the particular curve. Okay.
So this is 69 meters.
Okay. This particular section has a length of 69 meters.
So when I run this code,
it will give me a time of 1.5092 seconds. Okay, and it is telling me that the car is maintaining its speed till 52 meters, and after traveling 52 meters, it is braking. Okay. So see, I got this particular time 1.502 seconds, and it is maintaining its speed for 51 meters, and the remaining length is used for braking into the next corner. Okay.
This is how I obtained the results. Okay.
So similarly, I have obtained all the times
from turn 1 to turn 16.
Okay. So after adding all these times, I will get a total time of
82.078 seconds. Okay.
So that is the simulation time. And in 2016, Lewis Hamilton set a pole position lap time of 82 seconds. So both are matching with a great amount of accuracy.
Okay.
I have also obtained these acceleration values and braking values, and I have used this particular illustration
to show you
the similarity between our simulation as well as the theoretical data. So the first image you are seeing above is MATLAB simulation, and the image below is Lewis Hamilton time. Okay.
See, you can see 333 meters per second. 333 kilometers per hour is the top speed obtained in our simulation,
and theoretical data is 336.
Similarly, in turn 1, we got 116 and Hamilton got 136.
So this is because of some modeling inaccuracy.
Okay. It is showing only in turn 1,
but for all the remaining terms, it is saying same value.
See, 258, 255,
and then 293, 307. Okay. 268, 258, 97, 95, 270, 273. See, almost everywhere on the circuit, the speeds are matching almost within 10 km per hour difference only.
So,
you are able to simulate
with
a good amount of accuracy.
See, it is 133 and 133. Here it is exactly matching.
And in turn 10, here we got 70 kilometers, and Hamilton traveled with 73 kilometers per hour. Okay.
So that is, and this green color indicates that the car is accelerating, red color indicates the car is braking,
and yellow color indicates that
the car is maintaining at the
same speed. So after getting all the values, I plotted this data. This data shows
distance traveled by the car on x-axis
and speed on y-axis.
The blue color one indicates the MATLAB simulation, red color one indicates the Hamilton's practical data, and green color indicates Optimum G.
Optimum G is another software. Right now, I don't have that software because I simply changed my hard disk, so I lost that software.
But it is also another software which you can use to find out
lap time simulations.
Okay. So this green color is actually deviating a lot from our simulation as well as theoretical data, because
that software does not take user inputs, but it will use its own values.
Okay,
so that's why there are some differences here. Okay, so
what is more accurate is our MATLAB simulation only.
So this is the summary of the work that I did. Okay, so I hope you understood, and I hope that you found something useful out of this lap time simulation.
See, we covered some theory mechanics equations in the first, then we entered some of the theory of machines concepts, and then we used some MATLAB coding as well.
We also used some mathematics concepts, and we also tried how we can arrive at simulating the practical scenario
with some simple method, simple physics relations only.
Okay.
So this is how you can use your existing tools to simulate and predict practical engineering applications.
Okay. So hope you all understood. And conclusion of the video series briefly.
In the video 1, we derived the limiting velocity.
In video 2, we arrived at acceleration from force equations.
In video 3, we simulated the acceleration in MATLAB.
In video 4, we estimated the
straight line acceleration and braking into the next corner.
And in this final V5 video, we have put them all together to find out the final lap time. Okay.
So
now that you have completed listening to all this video series on introduction to vehicle dynamics with MATLAB, I would like to provide you with additional resources. So Chain by Refn is another great YouTube channel of Stuart Taylor. Okay.
So he posts always
Formula 1 related technical updates, and another channel is NPTEL. Okay.
So
Niket Kaisar is a professor from IIT. So his course on MATLAB is also great.
Okay.
So I will provide those links in the video description, so you can check them for additional resources and additional learning. So with this, I conclude this video series, and I will return you again with a new video series. Okay. Thank you very much.